Welcome to episode 38 of I Thought I Knew How, a podcast about knitting and life and all sorts. I'm your host, Anne Frost, and this episode was recorded on July 14th, 2020. Today I'm bringing you an interview with Karen Reel from Poppy's Pom Pom, a Canadian company producing upcycled fur pom-poms and exotic fiber yarns. Before we get to that, though, we have a bit of housekeeping to take care of, and I'll add a song in for us, too. Let's get started. First, an enthusiastic thank you to all my patrons for their ongoing support of the show. You are the ones that make this possible by keeping the bills paid. I just had a big website hosting fee come due, and I was able to cover it with my Patreon funds, which was a lovely feeling. If you'd like to help support the show, hop over to patreon.com/ithoughtiknewhow to see what the benefits are for sponsoring the show. Thank you to those of you who followed the I Thought I Knew How account over on Pinterest since the last episode. Feel free to send me an email at ann@familypodcasts.com if you have any tips on how I could be making that account more helpful for you. As I'm there making boards and such, I'm starting to get little light bulbs going off, like nightlight-sized light bulbs. About how Pinterest is helpful for people. I am starting to catch the vision. I have tried Pinterest twice before, and I think this might be the time it finally clicks for me. Progress is ongoing with the online International Fiber Festival. Vendor applications are coming in, and the days are continuing to come together. I will keep you posted about the festival as bigger developments come to be. We are getting very close to the start of the first in a series of three knit-alongs hosted by Morehouse Farm. I am co-hosting the first and third in the series. The series itself is to help us conquer lace. All the patterns we will be doing are from the book Shawls, Wraps, and Scarves by Louisa Harding. If you need that book, there will be a link in the show notes, but check your library, check your local yarn store, and if they don't have it and you use the Amazon link, that's an easy, small way to help support the show as well. The first pattern we will knit is the Lark's Alvina. For this shawl, you will need 2 of the 1-ounce skeins of lace from Morehouse Farm. That will be enough extra for you to be able to swatch as well. If you think you might want to extend the shawl by knitting one more repeat of the body of the shawl, you will need to buy a 1/3 ounce, even if you don't plan to swatch. On the Morehouse website, there are 3 links that will take you to their lace yarns. They are lace yarn, variegated lace yarn, and larger lace skeins. The lace yarn link just has their solid colors. I knit my test knit of the shawl in the Willow colorway, which is a very pale pastel green, and you can see how that turned out in the Facebook group and on Instagram. The variegated lace yarn link has some of their variegated options because the larger lace skeins link has more variegated options there. Be sure you check the size of those skeins because they come in 2 ounces and 4-ounce options. You will just need the 2-ounce size unless you want to get the 4-ounce maybe and make a couple of shawls from it. I will be doing the knit along with everyone else using the Monet's Garden variegated colorway. It has all the colors of the rainbow. I don't often use variegated yarns, but the pattern of the Lark's Alvina is fairly uncomplicated, and I think it will work well in a variegated. Plus, I think my oldest will really like it in the rainbow colors, and I knit the Willow version for my youngest, so 2 projects, 2 daughters, works out well. Now, the interview coming your way was a bit of an experiment. All of the interviews I have had for you so far have been recorded in person. But with all the COVID lockdown stuff going on, all my hopes of grabbing interviews at various festivals and events this year have completely bit the dust. And I came to the realization that I needed to start doing some interviews online. Karen Reel was my guinea pig, and it was a bit of a learning experience. She sounded fine on my end when we were talking, but the recording was not as clear. There are times when her side of the conversation is a little muffled and times when she's super clear. And I have done my best to clean up the audio and boost the quiet bits. For the most part, the start of the interview is the roughest part of it. So just stick it out for a few minutes or just skip the first few minutes if it's really hard for you to understand. And you have my apologies. Karen, you also have my apologies. I'm not quite sure why the recording was the way it was. Karen and her friend Trisha own a company called Poppy's Pom Pom. They make and sell upcycled fur pom-poms, Samoyed and Merino blend yarn, and Possum and Bulworth blend yarn. I am a big fan of their products, as you will hear in the interview. We also recorded a short video that will be available on the I Thought I Knew How YouTube account. It should go live at the same time that this recording goes live. So hop over there to meet Poppy and Stubbs and Karen and see their lovely products yourself. We are going to have a song real quick, and when we come back from the song, we'll go right into the interview. In the last episode, I had a song for those of you feeling a little wistful about a lost love. Today, I have one for those of you who are maybe feeling not so wistful. This is Mae Klingler. Oh, yes, it is. And it feels so uncharacteristic for her. It's a bit grumpy, but it's also lighthearted, and it is definitely funny. This is Mae, Lady Mae, Mae Klingler, with I Don't Miss You At All.
It when you call my name, so you can tell me all the lines you have written. No, I don't miss you at all, not even a little tiny bit. And if you stand beneath my wall, then a stone just might come falling. You're gonna lose your head.
Karen Real, who is one of the owners of Poppy's Pom Pom,
And we are going to talk today about Karen's knitting life and her company and the wonderful products that she has. So Karen, thank you for talking to me today.
Thank you so much for having the interview.
So you are based in Canada, is that right?
Yes. So we're located in Ottawa, Canada, and we try to keep as much of our product in Canada as well, as local as possible.
Now, when you say you try and keep it in Canada, you mean you try and source it in Canada?
Absolutely. Yes.
Because I know you were part of the Online International Fiber Festival in May, and so you were shipping all over.
All over the world. I was amazed at the places that people ordered yarn from. I was so excited to send to Ireland. There was a lady Cork who bought some yarn so she could make her son and his fiance, I think, some hats because they were dog lovers.
Oh, that's so sweet.
Yeah, it was really nice.
That's wonderful. It's so neat to think about all the places that, all the reach, you know, all the little connections yes, that we make.
Absolutely.
You did mention the dog. So that is...
That's your segue?
That is the big draw, right? That's Poppy and the Professor Yarns. I don't want to go that far yet. Let's back it up though first. When did you start knitting yourself?
I started crocheting first. I was about 20 and I learned how to crochet. And because at the time I had a boyfriend and his mother and aunt and everyone in the family crocheted, so I wanted to play too. They taught me how to crochet, and about 5 years later, I was in a job in a different city, and one of the women and I were talking about crocheting, and she said, oh, you need to learn to knit. So she taught me how to knit. So this is way more than 20 years ago.
What is it with knitters that they feel like they have to convert crocheters?
So true.
It's so true. But I started as a crocheter and then converted over. But my mother tried very, very hard to get me to knit before she gave up and taught me to crochet.
I almost recommend to start crocheting first, because the switch to continental knitting seems easier because you kind of hold the yarn the same way.
Yeah, our local yarn store owner here, that's her theory as well. When people come in and say, I want to learn how to knit, she will tell them, no, I'm going to teach you to crochet first.
Yeah.
And then I will teach you to knit. And it's for that same reason, because of holding it continental style.
I didn't know that was a real thing. I thought I was making that up.
But yeah, no, that's a thing. You've tapped into something. So you've been knitting for quite a while then. Awesome. And I saw on your website sort of a hint at your origin story for the business. You have your friend Tricia.
Yes.
That were this very interesting leap into the friendship. Do you want to tell us about that?
So great. Most people would describe me as very laid back. I should preface the story with that. But we have a mutual friend, Sandra. And Sandra called me one day because we all work for the government in the same department. Mm-hmm. So I knew Tricia, but not very well. So Sandra said, Tricia is not doing really well. Can you give her a call? Which was odd because I didn't know her very well. But I said, okay. So I called Tricia, and Tricia was upset because she was, I don't know, maybe in her late 20s or early 30s, and said, I'm never going to get a boyfriend. I'm going to be single forever, and I have nobody to climb Kilimanjaro with.
Oh,
such a random thing to say.
A very random.
I'll climb Kilimanjaro with you. Like, what? It's just a mountain. So we did it. We actually went the next year, and we climbed Kilimanjaro. And we were alone together for 3 weeks, so we're very, very close now. Of course, we know everything about each other.
So you two climbed Kilimanjaro alone?
We had porters.
Okay. Okay.
So we went, like, instead of going with a group of 20 or whatever, we just went the two of us.
Okay.
It was amazing. I highly recommend it. It's 5 days to climb up and then 1 day to climb down, to walk back down on your hobbled legs.
How much of it involves actual climbing?
There's only a small segment on the last day where it's all boulders and you really are hands and knees trying to get over boulders because there's no way around them. And it's really when you're exhausted and have no oxygen.
Yeah, so perfect timing.
Absolutely.
This adventure developed into a business adventure.
Yeah, so we have continued to work together. That was in 2007. So we continued to work together for the same department in different places since then. And then I guess maybe it was 2016 or 17, I started the business. And she was like, oh, that sounds like an awesome idea. Let's do it. Kind of like a let's climb Kilimanjaro. So she crochets. And so she does a lot of the crocheting. And can I tell you, she does all the math. I don't do any of the math. I can't. It's not my thing.
We all have our strengths. That's okay.
Mine is not math.
So you decided to go into business together.
Yes.
And you have several different things that we're going to talk about that are part of Poppy's Pom Pom. What was the first thing that made you think, yes, let's go into business doing this?
Probably don't even know this. Because I was crocheting at the time, I guess it was 4 years ago, I could make stuffies like a flamingo or what have you.
Okay.
So I have another friend who has a small business and was like, pressuring me, hardcore pressuring me, start a business, you need to sell these. So finally I relented and was like, okay, but they take a really long time to make. And so another friend said, do you know how to knit a hat? And I was like, I can knit a scarf, but I'll figure it out. And so I figured out not to read a pattern. I couldn't even read a pattern then. I designed my own, like a 2x2 rib hat, and made it for her and like frogged it until it was perfect. Mm-hmm. And then I gave it to her. That's when the business really started, knitting hats.
Okay. And you were just using whatever yarn appealed to you.
I was using like merino. Yeah.
Is that just selling to friends?
Absolutely. So I had an Etsy shop. Okay. So I was selling mostly to friends, and then the friend who asked me for the hat originally would wear a hat to work and someone would buy it off her head. So then I would have to make another hat.
Well, perfect.
Yes.
You have a free sales staff right there.
Perfect business model.
So what was the next step then?
So the hat needed a pom-pom because, of course, they're very popular, especially in Canada. And I really don't like acrylic. It's just a personal thing. I just don't like acrylic. And so after so many failed attempts at making pom-poms, I was like, okay, to get real fur, I need fur. So where do you get fur? I'm not going to go hunting because who has time? Yeah, who has time for that? So no, I was like, okay, well, where am I going to get fur? And so the first place I looked was Kijiji, which is like a Craigslist in Canada. And there was a woman selling a fur coat for $85. And I was like, what if I go buy this fur coat off this woman and say it's for my mother, because I'm not going to tell her I'm going to cut it into a million pieces. She might be upset. So I buy this coat and I take it home and I'm like, what do I do with a fur coat? So I watched YouTube videos on how to make pom-poms, and I cut up a fur coat in my kitchen and I sewed it into, I know it was terrible, and I sewed it into pom-poms.
You had made some pom-poms before using
like
other
like
materials.
Fabric. Yeah. And I've made wool pom-poms and it's just not for me.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, no, I want a beautiful fur pom-pom, but I don't want to kill any animals.
There are all these fur coats floating around that
fur coats, yeah,
are not willing to wear anymore, or they don't want to because the fashion's gone, you know. No,
and you don't want to just throw them in a landfill because it's so bad for the environment as well. So
yeah.
So I started buying fur coats, literally cutting them in my kitchen on the island, vacuuming, and then and then sewing them by hand still into a pom-pom.
Uh-huh. So how many coats do you go through in a year, do you think?
I'm going to say last year we probably went through between 10 and 15. And then right now at home, I probably have 10 fur coats waiting to be cut up.
Yeah, I think I saw the other day you mentioned you were going to pick up some coats. Time to restock.
I'm always searching coats.
Yeah, I imagine.
Yeah.
Just a few weeks before we made contact, I needed a pom-pom. And I'd ordered some on Amazon, and it was like a 12-pack.
Yes.
I only needed one, but I could only buy it as a 12-pack. So I still have some of those. But then I have one of your beautiful fur ones. Yes. And so we're actually going to do a video after this interview, because I want people to see the difference between them and the yarns and some other things we're going to talk about in the video format as well. So you'll need to hop over to I Thought I Knew How podcast on YouTube and look for the video there. And I'll put the link in the show notes for that. And you can see, because the difference is dramatic between a real fur pom-pom and the acrylic pom-pom.
And I think at that time, it would be good for us to talk about the difference in environmental impact as well, which is reason I don't like acrylic.
Well, absolutely. And I think my listeners have heard me talk about my daughter's campaign to convert us to zero waste.
That's fantastic.
Which is great until you're trying to live it. It's very challenging. I'm trying to be supportive. And in many ways, it has been a wonderful experience and to learn the different ways. But some of the things are easier than others. And one of the things was using natural items for crafting, so switching to full wool, full cotton, things like that, and trying to get out of the blends and out of the acrylics. Because once you really start paying attention, you start noticing how superior the natural fibers are. Now, when you started making the pom-poms, were you making it just to go on the hats, or were you making them to sell separately?
No, I was just making them to go on the hats. And so I was sewing them directly on the hat.
Oh, okay.
But then I decided that was a problem, because how would you wash your hat?
Right.
So I tried to make the pom-poms with long threads so you could tie it on the hat. Again, it's hard to untie. Some people suggested a snap button, like on a onesie for a baby.
Right.
But then if you take the pom-pom off, you have a snap on top of your head. So I ended up trying out a lobster clasp. So it hooks directly into the wool, so you don't see it, and it's easy to remove. So you can switch the pom-pom.
Perfect. When did you start selling them separately?
There's this art and craft fair show called the One of a Kind Show in Toronto every year. And we were lucky enough to get in to the show a few springs ago. Trisha was lucky enough to be in Cuba on vacation at the time. So I went to the show and I had pom-poms and hats. And knitters came and said, we need pom-poms. And so we started selling pom-poms separately. I didn't realize the need for pom-poms was so big, because I guess not a lot of people make them, and especially not from natural fur.
Yeah, well, the fashion for pom-poms, I feel like, has really exploded in the last few years.
Yes, I agree.
I remember, I'm trying to think when the last time I had to wear a woolly hat, which was probably 20 years ago now, because I moved to Arizona and then I was in the Philippines. 20 years ago, it was, you didn't want a pom-pom on your hat. That was nerdy. But now they've made that resurgence. And I think part of the reason is because of the furry pom-pom look. Is very different from like the 80s pom-pom that we made.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a very different, softer, fluffier look. It's very different, very appealing.
It looks warm.
Like
warm and inviting for something that you use in the winter, which is not warm and inviting at all.
Exactly. You're making pom-poms, you're knitting hats.
Yep.
Then you have some new friends come into your life.
So I, at the time, had this amazing golden retriever. His name was Boston. We had him for 12 years or so, and he was such a great guy. And when he was about 11, I said to my son, we really should get a Samoyed. And my son was probably 10 or 11 at the time. And I kept talking about it all the time because I grew up with a Samoyed, and I loved them. One day, I spoke with a breeder, and I was preparing to get a Samoyed puppy when they had a 9-month-old puppy that was available that was a show puppy. They weren't going to breed her, so she was available.
Okay.
And they said, why don't you come down and meet her and see if it's good? I didn't tell my son, so I just said, I'm going out. I'll be home later. I went and I met the dog, and she jumped out of the crate all over me. And I was like, oh, she's so cute. She's like this big, so much fur. And I'm like, wow, this is amazing. What's her name? And they said, her name's Poppy, but her name is really Cherry Pop-Tart, but it's Poppy for short. So her registered name is Cherry Pop-Tart. And Poppy is just such a British name that I love it, like Poppy, Pippa. So I'm like, oh, that's perfect. So yeah, of course I'll take Poppy home. So I took her home and I surprised my son and I surprised my golden retriever. And they were so excited. And I can't even explain to you how much energy a Samoyed has. Like, if you could think of the most energetic dog in the world, like, that's a Samoyed. So I didn't know what I was in for, but I soon figured out she needed to go to daycare because otherwise she would rip the house apart.
So were you thinking that you needed to get a second dog just because you wanted a second dog?
Yes.
Okay. So, so Boston didn't need a friend.
Well, poor Boston. My son didn't need a dog. It's always me. I'm always like, I think we should get another dog.
Okay.
And I'll say, I'm getting it for Boston. I'm getting it for Riley. But no, it's always for me. But I don't admit that to anyone else.
That's okay. We won't tell anyone about this. Because I was going to say, like, did you, like, think Boston needs a friend, and then you brought in Poppy, and then it was like, oh, no, Poppy is now
crazy.
But Poppy was for you all along, so that's okay.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So when I was growing up, we had a Samoyed. My parents got the Samoyed just before I was born, so I really grew up with her. And so all through the 80s, my mom was like, you know, you could spin this into yarn. So she would save it for who knows how long, but she would never spin it into yarn. Never, never, never.
Did she spin?
No.
Okay.
She knit, but she didn't spin. I guess maybe she didn't know anyone who spun. I'm sure there was a reason. She had too many kids to look after. So when I got Poppy, I kept saying, I'm going to spin this into yarn. And so I did a bunch of research. I guess my mother didn't have Google, right? So
yeah,
I did a bunch of Googling and I went to a twist festival in Saint-André-d'Avelin in Quebec. And I met a woman there who spins by hand. And I said to her, I have a Samoyed. Can I give you some of her fur and have you spin it into yarn? She said, yes, of course. So I went to her house, I'm sure with Poppy, of course, and a bag of fur. And she spun it for me, and it was beautiful, but it was itchy, like really itchy.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Especially now, I say interesting because I have your current yarn.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. And we'll talk more about that later, but that that really surprises me. Okay, go on.
Very, very.
I don't want people to get stuck on that and think, oh, no, it's itchy, and stop listening.
Because, yeah.
Yeah.
Don't stop listening. So she mixed it with a kind of sheep called a fin sheep. I don't really know anything about sheep, but apparently they're very itchy.
So it was the blended fiber.
Yes,
it was the blend. Okay.
Right. So I was super disappointed. And I guess it was probably 6 more months of looking on Google.
Mm-hmm.
And I found a small mill that would spin it with merino for me.
That's what I have.
That's what you have. Yes. So this mill already had some Samoyed yarn, so I got to see it in person. And so then I started collecting more of Poppy's fur, more and more and more, and uh-huh. sending it to the mill to be spun for myself, for my own personal knitting.
I've been learning about small batches, you know, people doing small processes of their, like maybe their farm yarn, or they go and collect their own fleeces and have it sent. And I know there needs to be sort of a critical mass before they can function, before it'll function in the machinery. How much fur do you need to collect in order to make a batch of the yarn?
So the minimum was 3 pounds, which is
a lot.
Well,
oh, okay.
It's feathers, right? It's so light.
Well, that's true, yeah. So how big size-wise, like if you paint a picture for us of how
so
much...
So if you have a paper grocery bag.
Okay.
Stuffed full, like pushed down, stuffed full, that's probably how much you need.
Okay. And then that's getting blended also with some merino.
Right. So 25% merino.
Okay.
And it's blended because Samoyed fur is too hot to wear on its own.
Which I'm very thrilled about because I'm always cold.
So it's
perfect. Yeah. Well, I'll share. I did knit a project with it and I'll show that off when we have our video time together. But yeah, that was something I was getting a sense for as I was knitting with it, is just how fluffy it gets and therefore, you know, insulating. I was thinking,
yes.
Like, these are going to be great in like October.
Absolutely. Even just when the air conditioning's on high.
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to ask you some questions that I already know the answer to because I've already worked with the yarn, but I know they're the sorts of things that people are going to be curious about because it is such an unusual fiber. Does it smell like dog still once it's been processed?
Samoyeds have no smell, which is an interesting fact. So Samoyeds are hypoallergenic, so most people wouldn't even be allergic to the dog. They don't smell like a dog to begin with, and when the fiber is sent to the mill, it's washed. It gets wet, like if when you block it, it still doesn't smell like a dog.
Now that you have answered that, I will agree with you. It does not smell. In fact, when I first got it, I, you know, did the sniff test.
Of course.
I always smell yarn because that's what knitters do.
Yes.
And to me, it smelled like merino. It smelled like wool.
Yes.
From the 25%. So
if you have it around a dog, the dog will know that it smells like a dog.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, that's funny. So if I want to make friends with the dog, wear some of the Poppy and the Professor yarn.
Yes.
That's good to know because I like to be friends with doggies.
Too.
So once you have it knit up into something, how do you take care of it?
So I take care of it the same way I take care of merino, like cold water, hand wash, lay flat okay. to dry.
Okay.
When I knit something like a hat and you wear it so many times, it stretches out. Mm-hmm. I hand wash it cold water, lay flat till it's mostly dry, and then I put in the dryer for like 3 minutes. And it okay. goes back to its regular size.
Now, if we're not careful with it, will it felt?
Oh, I've never had it felt.
Oh, okay. So that's yeah. safety.
Yes.
Good to know. Okay.
I mean, it could happen, but it's not happened to me.
Okay. Yeah, we'll put a disclaimer in there.
Yeah. Yet.
Where are you getting all this fur?
If I want to have more yarn, then I need to have more fur. So it would be a constant question in my mind. How can I get more fur? So Poppy, of course, knows every Samoyed that lives near us because it's a really tight community. There are Facebook groups. There are Samoyed rescue associations. But just the Samoyeds in our tiny area all go to daycare because they are crazy wild beasts. So I know all of those dogs, and the owners save the fur for me. And then the breeder saves all of the fur for me. So I've been more present on Facebook groups for people that have Samoyeds, mm-hmm. and everyone has been saving the fur for me. It's, I know, it's really such a nice little community. of Samoyeds. There are Samoyed meetups at the dog park. So we go play with all the other dogs and everyone saves the fur for me. Or I go to their house and pick it up and hug their dog. And yeah.
So how often do you end up with enough fur to be able to send it through the mill?
So it was about twice a year up until now. And I'm working towards doing it monthly. I had an interview with a professor of entrepreneurship recently, and she told me that I'm only limited by the number of Samoyeds there are, and there are thousands of them.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think when people take the time to try out the yarn, they're going to be surprised by the qualities that it has.
Yes.
We can do sort of show and tell when we have our video, but the thing that I really liked about working with it is I love the halo effect that you get from mohair, but yes. I get an itch factor from many mohair yarns. And that is not something that happened at all with this yarn. So you get the beautiful, lovely halo, but it's soft. I have no prickle reaction at all from it.
It's kind of like an Angora, but it's fluffier even than an Angora.
Yeah. And I even noticed, because I messed up and cast on the wrong size for the leg warmers that I used it on and had to start over. So I had to frog it and use it again. And I had to do that twice. So it was very fluffy by the time I knit it properly.
Oh, absolutely.
But it also was staying together. I adored working with this and finding this alternative for the mohair halo effect.
I love that you said that, because mohair is so popular right now, but I also find it very itchy. Like, I can't use it.
Yeah.
Just love so much how it looks.
Yeah. So I'm looking forward to showing off my leg warmers in the video. And showing, I'm hoping that we can really show people the floof factor.
There's a lot of floof. Actually, that's just what I call it, the Samoyed floof.
The floof effect.
Yeah.
So on your website, you actually have some patterns for people to knit with the Poppy and the Professor Samoyed yarn. Some hat patterns, I believe.
So right now I'm actually working on a pair of mittens. But on my Instagram in the stories, there's one story called Your Knits, and it's pictures that people have sent me of things they've knit with the Samoyed yarn. So it's just like inspiration for everyone to see what can be made.
So I have some of the Samoyed fiber left, or the yarn that you sent me. And my thought with it is actually to do a hat. I recently did the basic Norwegian star hat, which is a pattern available on Ravelry for free. And it's a worsted pattern, which I think this would work well for. I think it's labeled as a DK, but it's a floofy VK. And my thought is to do the Fair Isle star around it in the Samoyed fiber, and then have like a dark background, but just have the floof pattern. So that's my next plan, to finish that off. So you realized that if you were going to continue this, that you needed to collect more fiber, and you had friends and community members saving it for you. But apparently that was not enough.
It's never enough. Again, back to Trisha. Trisha is not just the math whiz. She's my voice of reason. So I would say to her, do you think I should get a puppy? And she would say, you don't need a puppy. She's a voice of reason. So then I'd wait a month or two. Do you think I should get a puppy? So I went to my first yarn show, like just dedicated to yarn fiber knitting show in Quebec. And I had never been to a yarn show before, only ever to like a craft show. Mm-hmm. So this was all knitters and then vendors, what have you. And I sold out of the Samoyed yarn. I had a poster that said, do you want to see a picture of my dog? Because I say it all the time. And then at the bottom it said, do you want to touch your fur? So I sold out of yarn. I completely did much better than I expected. People were going crazy saying, are you the dog yarn lady coming to the booth from outside searching for me? So I texted Trisha and said, can I get a puppy? And she said, yes, now you can get a puppy. So once again, without telling my son, I contacted the breeder and I said, okay, Poppy's 5. I'm ready for another dog. Mm-hmm. You have some 4 or 5 month old females that are available. What do you think? And she wrote me back and she's like, oh no, I have the perfect male puppy for you. He lost his tail in an accident.
Oh.
And so my heart was broken and I was like, of course I need that dog.
Yeah.
So she sent me pictures and he had 1/3 of a tail. And normally a Samoyed's tail goes over its back.
Yeah, it curves. So
So it has a stub tail.
Oh.
So okay. I named him Stubbs.
Yeah.
Stubbs isn't fancy like cherry Pop-Tart. So we named him Professor Stubbs because he has his PhD in chemistry and dyeing yarn.
So that's where the professor comes from.
Poppy and the professor.
Okay. That makes sense now. All right.
The Stubbs, yeah.
So do you ever have it dyed? Do you ever have the Samoyed yarn dyed? Because it's such a beautiful white base.
It is beautiful as white. So the first time I dyed it, I used avocado pits and skins because of the environmental factor. And it comes out this beautiful blush pink.
Oh.
So then I met.
And then with the halo.
Yes.
That would have been gorgeous.
Yeah. So then I met Julie Sindenham, the Love of Color.
Okay. Yeah. She was in the festival too.
Yeah. So I talked to her quite a bit about dyeing, and I tried out all of her lovely, amazing botanical products, and it dyes really well, not as bright as merino, because Samoyed fiber naturally rejects dirt. I don't know how else to say it. Uh-huh. If Poppy goes in the mud and then lays on the ground in the night, in the morning, the dirt will all be on the ground and not on the dog. Like, they naturally just get rid of dirt. And I say it's the Samoyed fairies coming to clean the dog.
Can we figure this technology out for, like, a 3-year-old human child?
So the dye doesn't stick as brightly as it does for merino, but it sticks, like, in beautiful pastels. I've done botanical dyes with my son's girlfriend. She's 18 and she is very, very talented at putting colors together. And then we recently tried acid dyes as well, and they are beautiful. So we sometimes have Samoyed yarn in color too.
So should people just sort of stalk the website for that?
Absolutely. And I'll put on Instagram if we're dyeing. I've dyed with black currant as well, which is one of my favorite flavors. I have a black currant bush at my house. So we harvested the black currants and we made it into dye.
Wonderful.
So, yeah.
Okay. So people can keep the eye out, or they can just order it themselves and give it a go.
They can dye it themselves. Absolutely. Dye it
themselves. Wonderful. So you have 2 dogs now that you're drawing fiber from and loving and enriching their life in other ways.
Yeah. They are really something. Like, they're so fantastic.
Now that you have 2 of them, do they still need to go to doggy daycare, or can they behave together on their own?
So the worst thing that happened is that the daycare and the dog parks closed.
Oh, right.
Was 9 months old.
Oh, no.
So we were only able to walk them on a leash, and that's not enough for a Samoyed. They need to run. So it was a very difficult, trying time. Even his obedience classes were canceled. The dog parks are open again. I'm glad we're going, but he doesn't need to go to daycare because we go to Samoyed meetups now, or we have so many Samoyed friends that we just go to their backyard and then they play.
Let them play together.
Like a pack of wolves. Yeah.
You have your business.
Yes.
You're still making fur pom-poms that are beautiful. You're making lovely fluffy yarn out of your canine friends.
Yes.
Not out of them, out of their fur.
Your fur. You didn't ask how I get their fur.
Oh, should I ask how do you get their fur? I imagine you'd brush them.
Yes. But people ask me all the time if I shave them. No, I don't.
Yeah, let's clarify that, because I know, like, for Angora people, they do have to, they don't shave, they cut.
Right.
The fiber off. No,
a Samoyed has an undercoat that grows. So the long hair on top, the brush hair, grows from 1 to 3 years, and that is the part that would be itchy. So it does not go into the yarn. The undercoat replaces itself every 3 to 6 months. So I just brush them, brush out their undercoat, and save that.
And is this something that you have to do every day?
Not quite every day, but a couple times a week. People would be upset if I was shaving. I think about it sometimes when I like vacuum. Even though I collect all their fur off them with the brush, I still have to vacuum every day.
You did a trip to New Zealand.
Yes.
And you came back with some possum fur and Polwarth blend yarn.
Yes.
When you went to New Zealand, did you plan to bring that back with you?
So I've been to New Zealand more than once. In 2016, I went to Australia for work for 6 weeks. And so I added a week of New Zealand onto the trip because I was already that far from home. Okay. So in Australia, I found a lot of knits that were made of possum. And I was surprised because in North America, possum is not fluffy and nice. So when I ended up in New Zealand, I, of course, went to all the yarn stores. And I was learning,
of course. You all understand that.
I learned a lot about how possums are an invasive species that were introduced to New Zealand. And New Zealand has no natural predators. That means that possums have no predators. So possums are killing off the New Zealand wildlife at a much faster rate than they can stop it. In New Zealand, they cull possums, as it has to happen. Just like in Australia, they have to cull the rabbits because they destroy the environment. They started blending it with sheep's wool, knitting with it. So now there's no fur industry in New Zealand. So now people are paid to go out and take care of the possum problem. And companies will buy the fur and sell it to mills to turn into yarn. So for me, it was the environmental factor. They can't live there anyways. And it seems, I don't want to say wasteful. It seems a shame that they have to cull the possums that are already there. They have to get rid of the problem.
Yeah.
It's kind of, I don't know. It's not a benefit, but it's a nicer way to think about it, that the possum was alive for a reason, not just to go around and ruin New Zealand.
The episode that comes out before this one, I'm going to be sort of walking people through the issue there. So hopefully people have a better understanding, because you're right, it is sad. No one wants to think about people going out and trapping for fur. But this isn't the same as trapping for fur to make into the fur coats, like in the 30s and 40s. Right. This is widespread devastation of the environment is happening because of these animals. And it's not their fault. And that's unfortunate. They were an introduced species. So on your first trip, you were exposed to possum fur.
Right. And I loved it right away. So my friend invited me to go to New Zealand with her two small children in a Winnebago this year. And I said, yes, of course. But I flew ahead of her and made arrangements to go to a mill so that I could get some possum yarn. So I've added that to the shop just because I love the story behind it. And it also has, it's very soft and has a bit of a halo as well. So I think it's a good addition to the Samoyed yarn.
So is it your intention then to continue importing it? Or was this sort of a one-off? I'm here.
Have been a one-off, but we'll see how it goes.
Okay. Because I really liked that as well.
It's not easy to find in Canada, so I'm not sure how it is in the States, but I haven't been able to find it in Canada.
It's possible to find in certain yarn stores that have taken a chance on it, but okay. It's imported, obviously, because it's coming from New Zealand.
Right.
And I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about what it is because of, first of all, because of the possum issue. They're totally different animals. The fiber is completely different. And then also the misunderstanding about why the New Zealand possum fiber trade is happening.
Right. Yep.
People don't understand.
Absolutely.
So I think it's a bit of an uphill climb for it here in the States. So with the International Fiber Festival that we did, that's when I really started delving into it more myself. And I sort of known about possum fiber, but I hadn't really gone in depth about it. And your yarn is the first that I've used. I have purchased some possum yarn. But it's been very low content. So the possum yarn I bought before was only like 10% or something. It wasn't, it's just like using wool. There's no difference to it. Your yarn arrived and it looked like just like a heathered gray yarn, a heathered gray wool yarn. And I thought, oh, well, okay. It looks like wool. It's going to behave like wool. And then I started using it. And again, as you said, this beautiful halo starts to develop as you're using it. And it's not as pronounced as the Samoyed yarn, but it's still lovely floof. And it's soft. And it has a level of silkiness to it as well. I am a big fan of both the yarns. Yeah. And so I would encourage people to give it a try. And see what it's like to work with them. Oh, and one thing I noticed about your yarn as I was working with it is that it is a Z-twist yarn. And I don't know if you, okay.
I don't, so, tell me what it means.
As yarns are plied together, it can either go in an S direction or in a Z direction. Okay. And for a lot of people, it doesn't matter. It won't influence it at all. But for some crocheters, having a Z-twist yarn will prevent the yarn from getting all crazy or untwisting as you use it.
Wow.
Because of the motions of the crochet, it can start to untwist some S-twist yarns. And then for some knitters, there's ways of holding the yarn that can also start to untwist if you're using an S-twist yarn. But then also, and the reason why I noticed this is because I was starting a class on twined knitting and they recommend a Z-twist yarn for twined knitting, which is, oh gosh, I'm going to get it wrong. I want to say it's a Bavarian knitting technique, but it creates a very dense fabric and I'm not that far into the class yet, so I can't speak a whole bunch of it. But I heard, okay, the instructor said, find a Z-twist yarn. And I got online and was searching all over and finally found someone on a ranch in Montana or something who produces a Z-twist and ordered from her. And but then I was working on the leg warmers with your yarn. And I was like, wait a minute, this is a Z-twist yarn.
So I need to add it to my website.
So yes, because people search for it. People search for it looking for this special Z-twist yarn. It's just, you know, for a lot of people, it's not going to make a difference. But for some, for the people who are looking for it,
absolutely,
they're going to be like, oh, Z-twist yarn. Wonderful. So anyway, there's a little sidetrack. So on your trip to New Zealand, you said you went to all the yarn stores. Did you really go to all the yarn stores?
So the first time we went, I was in Tauranga. So I did Auckland, but we mostly went to Tauranga and we went to the national park there that they filmed Lord of the Rings.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So I really wanted to go hiking in the mountains because that's what New Zealand is. So the yarn store that I went to there was in Tauranga, which is a small town. But this year when I went to New Zealand, on my first day, just straight landed, got a car, hopped in the car, went to a mill and learned... straight to the mill and learned about the possum, more about the possum industry. Mm-hmm. And then I went to a couple in the Winnebago with the kids. I went to a couple little towns. One of them is Wanaka, which I highly recommend. So in Wanaka, there was a Wanaka local yarn store, and I bought some lace weight, and it might be mohair, it might be itchy, but it was beautiful. A lace weight, locally dyed yarn that I really loved. But also there was a retail store called Perium, which is a sheep farm in Wanaka, and they have their own merino sheep, and they produce yarn, but they also produce knitted clothing, which was amazing, and I really would love to buy some of it.
Is it hand knit or is it machine knit?
No, it was hand knit.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful stuff. That might be it for the yarn store. No, I went to another yarn store in Christchurch because I didn't pack enough needles.
Oh, no.
So I looked at all of the local yarn, of course, because it's what I love. But I ended up buying needles there and talking to the woman. Lovely. But yes, all the yarn stores in New Zealand. Amazing.
Wonderful. So I did notice, looking, as you know, preparing for the festival, that there were quite a few festivals and things that go on down there around knitting. There's a handful of those. So it's good to know that that's going on and there is a thriving knitting community going on, it sounds like.
Yes. And it's a beautiful country. You need to add it to your list.
Yeah, I know. You know, when we lived in the Philippines, we thought, well, we should go to Australia while we're here. And then we should go to New Zealand while we're there. Yes. But then when you look at how difficult it's going to be to get there, just because of where we would have been coming in the Philippines to get to Australia, it was almost going to take as long as if we came from the US anyway. So we were like, well, we'll just do it when we do it then at that point. But that's definitely something that we hope to do someday. I just need to start making the millions. That's and all.
Being allowed out of the house would help too.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, Karen, I want to thank you for being on the podcast. And I'm not saying goodbye, though, because we are going to continue this over on the YouTube channel. But in case there's anyone who doesn't go over and watch the video, would you like to give us your social media information and all of that good stuff?
Sure. So we have a website, and it's poppiespompom.com. Instagram is also poppiespompom. Facebook as well. And I have a Twitter, which I hardly use, but it's Poppy and the Prof. And Poppy and the Prof also have a YouTube channel, which I hardly ever update. But of course, that's where I post the dog videos.
Dog videos, yeah. And are we going to get to see the dogs?
Yes, I'm going to go get the dogs.
Okay, awesome. So we are going to pause this for a little bit. And everyone should hop over to I Thought I Knew How podcast on YouTube to check out the video. And we will see you there.
A few more things before I go. Remember that in the last episode, we had a giveaway from the Knit Swag store on Etsy. Listen to episode 37 for details and then hop over to the Facebook group to enter. Kelly hopped into the contest thread on Facebook and offered a coupon for 15% off most of the items in her Etsy shop. The code is AwesomePossum, all caps, all one word. Put the item in your cart and then view your shopping cart to enter the code and see if what you are ordering is covered by the coupon. I ended up ordering another set of note cards and the customized notebook that looks like it was knit with speckled yarn, and it has my name in knit stitches across the front. The note cards were covered by the coupon. The notebook was not, but I wanted it, so I got it anyway. So it's on its way to me now. I am looking forward to having that. Anyway, the giveaway winner will be picked on July 22nd, 2020, so you only have a few days after this goes live to get your entry in. And one last reminder to hop over to the I Thought I Knew How YouTube account to see the video of the Samoyeds behind Poppy and the Professor yarn. Thank you again, Karen, for taking the time to visit with us. I will talk to you all again in a week. In the meantime, Thank you for listening and knitting with me for a bit. If you would like to support the show, please visit patreon.com/ithoughtiknewhow to make a monthly pledge, or visit ko-fi.com, that's ko-fi.com/ithoughtiknewhow to make a one-time donation to the podcast. You may also consider making a purchase from one of our sponsors by visiting the website ithoughtiknewhow.familypodcasts.com and clicking the link at the top that says Be a Booster. While you're on the site, you can also find the show notes for each episode. Find me on my social media accounts as I Thought I Knew How, except on Twitter, where it's just Thought I Knew How. The groups on Ravelry and Facebook are both called I Thought I Knew How Podcast. Until next time, may you be blessed with stitches that never drop, yarn without joins, and plenty of time to knit.